Welcome, everyone. Thanks for joining us. My name is Amanda Williams, and joining me is Jim Zobel, and we are both historians here at the MacArthur Memorial. And it is no secret that Douglas MacArthur's relationship with the U.S. Navy and the Marine Corps was complicated in World War II. But what about during the Korean War? The Korean War was a very different war, obviously, but just as in World War I, the U.S. Navy and the United States Marine Corps were going to play an important role in MacArthur's operations in the Korean War. So today we're going to be discussing some of those operations and the relationship that MacArthur had with both services. So Jim, let's get started. June 1950, North Korea invades South Korea. In early July 1950, MacArthur is named Commander-in-Chief of the United Nations Command, and he's tasked with liberating South Korea. He's 70 years old at this point, and his generation of officers are long retired, and most of his World War II staff is retired. So who are the Navy and the Marine Corps commanders that MacArthur is going to be working with during the Korean War?
Well, like you said, the Navy guys from World War II have pretty much gone. Halsey's gone, Spruance is gone, Nimitz is gone. But some of these commanders are going to be people that he worked with during World War II. Forrest Sherman, who MacArthur had worked with, had worked under Nimitz, but they had combined operations at Hollandia and then later on. And he's now Chief of Naval Operations. And so Sherman and MacArthur will know each other. Arthur Struble, he had served in the Southwest Pacific, South Pacific, and Central Pacific as well. MacArthur knows him. He's going to run 7th Fleet. That's one of the main, the main battle fleet that they have there in Japan. And then C. Turner Joy is going to be the commander of Naval Forces Far East. He had served out in the Aleutian campaigns, had worked in naval war plans back in Washington, and had a big, role later on in those final campaigns towards Japan. And then James Doyle, Rear Admiral James Doyle, he'll run that amphibious fleet for MacArthur. And these guys are all complete consummate professionals. Doyle had worked with the architect Richmond Kelly Turner, and they were able to pretty much have a complete confidence of going in, and MacArthur will have all their confidence, and he will look to them as the professionals that they are. There's no real problems that happen to them. MacArthur does a lot of things, but they'll do what they, they're ordered to do. And they'll think about things, but they're like, nope, I got this job. This is the job I got to do now. The Marine Corps, the main guys that MacArthur deals with are Lemuel Shepard. He's Fleet Marine Forces Commander for the Pacific. And then O.P. Smith, who's the Major General that will run the 1st Marine Division there. And MacArthur will have more contact with those two than anyone else, especially with the Incheon operation. After that, Smith will have to deal more with Edward Almond, who's going to be the Corps commander, the Army Corps commander that runs him. But again, these guys are all World War II veterans. MacArthur knew Lemuel Shepard because he had been assistant division commander for the 1st Marine Division there on New Britain when MacArthur does those Cape Gloucester landings. And those two will be instrumental in getting the Marines into the fight in Korea. And then O.P. Smith is, he's the man. I mean, the main reason why the Marines do so well, in that early grueling period is because of O.P. Smith. And he's, had been, a regimental commander on Peleliu during World War II. And he's the guy who puts together the 1st Marine Division, out of nothing. And they'll bring in a lot of people that MacArthur doesn't really work with, but, those famous names, Chesty Puller, Ray Murray, Ray Davis, Homer Litzenberg, all these guys that are going to run the 1st, 5th, and 7th Marine Regiments, Taplett's in there. And these guys are it. He's got some really great people that he can rely on.
From the start of the Korean War, it's pretty clear that the Navy is not going to have to deal with hostile fleets, like it had to deal with during World War II. So what is the main role of the Navy going to be in this war? And is that clear to both MacArthur and the Navy in the summer of 1950? Or is that something that kind of evolves as the months go on?
Well, just because the war evolves, they'll know what they have to do immediately on. And they'll learn that they made some mistakes during the interwar period. During the interwar period, the Navy, like the Army and the Marine Corps, was ground down to almost nothing. They only have skeletal forces there in Japan as well as the Philippines. When the war starts, the only battleship you have, heavy battleship, is the Missouri. They're going to have to bring the other three Iowa-class battleships out of mothballs. You've only got the Valley Forge, I think, and the Badong Strait and the Sicily aircraft carriers that will be brought out there. But once that call for war goes, ships start pouring into the Far East towards Japan. Turner Joy gets COMNAV-V really built back up. They'll bring the USS Princeton out of mothballs. He's got like a couple of cruisers over there, but you know they need that big battle wagon, which will be the Missouri, coming in there about September. The thing is in those first few days, they are immediately caught up in trying to stop that North Korean drive coming down. So you're going to be using a lot of air power, a lot of close air support, like you said, that they didn't have as they're going in, an idea of what was going on, but it's going to be figured out real quick. When MacArthur goes over there and visits Seoul that first day on June 30th, when he goes to sit there and watch, I mean, he comes back and he's got in mind an amphibious invasion for Incheon called Blue Hearts, using the 1st Cavalry Division. And so Admiral Doyle will know almost immediately that, you know, they're going to be looking at using amphibious moves to be able to counter this threat. The thing is during the interwar period, the Navy had gotten rid of all those amphibious ships, you know, those LSTs, those right. LCIs, the LCIs, all these things. You know, there's no attack transports out there. They're going to have to send all that out there. Doyle immediately culls everything he can get together to put together. But the other main thing is the biggest problem of the Korean War for the Navy is going to be mine warfare, because the Soviets are going to help the North Koreans mine all those harbors at Wonsan, Iwan. They won't get to Incheon, you know, before the invasion goes through, but they've only got 10 minesweepers out there. And they're going to lose those in the first days when they go into Wonsan. So that drawdown during that interwar period was really the biggest thing that's going to hamper naval operations in Korea. But it goes to say again, you know, these guys, Joy, Struble, especially James Doyle, they're going to be able to bring all the material they need to get together to pull off these things. And, you know, when they get an inch on, that's the most ships that have gathered for anything since World War II, you know, bigger than anything that happened in Vietnam or anything like that. And so the Navy's going to really be running a lot of shore bombardment, you know, aiding troops as far as there are close to the coast, a lot of interdiction with air power, because they'll bring in those other aircraft carriers, you know, especially by the winter of 1950. And they're going to be doing a lot of amphibious operations and a lot of close in raiding with destroyers. And you know, it's wild because you're sitting there going into the jet age. You know, the Navy will start bringing in jets, but when you get into some of these minesweeping operations, you're having small ship confrontations with shore batteries. And so it's basically old style,
like the warfare, old days,
you know, right. Navy. Yeah, you know, old style Navy warfare, along with, you know, this new jet age and, you know, all the modern weapons of warfare. So it's, you know, a lot of people look at it as, oh, they didn't really have a job. It's the Navy's performance in Korea is unbelievable, just because of what they had to pull together to make it even work.
Right. All right, well, we've mentioned amphibious operations, so let's talk about Incheon. This is what some scholars refer to as MacArthur's 5,000-to-1 gamble. And basically, MacArthur plans a very bold, but also very risky amphibious operation at Incheon. And the Navy, initially, is not on board with this plan at all, because it really just sounds like a terrible, terrible disaster waiting to happen. So walk us through the process by which MacArthur convinces the Joint Chiefs or convinces the Navy to greenlight Incheon.
Well, that big problem is as you know, is those tides. When you for a LST, which is a landing ship tank, and that's the thing, they didn't have any LSTs out there, but there were 17 of them that they had given to the Japanese. They were using them as merchant marine ships. They were using them as fishing vessels. You know, they were just completely trashed by this point, but they'll bring those things together to be able to use. And for a LST to get in, you need 29 feet of water. And the only way that you can do that at Incheon is at the high tides. And so the big problem is when you land those LSTs, they're going to be stuck there until the next high tide comes in. So that was the big worry. As well, the currents going in there are just phenomenal going in and out because of that big tidal shift. And then flying fish channel, getting in this very narrow channel. You know, there are a lot of the naval guys were very worried about that. That'll come up later in the conference. But so a lot of the JCS, especially, you know, because MacArthur doesn't really tell him he's going to do Incheon until like the 1st of August. And they're kind of like, hey, man, you planning an amphibious invasion out there? And he's like, well, yeah, actually. And they're like, where are you going, Incheon? And they're all like, what? You know, but the thing is, that's the rail hub. You know, that's where all the supply lines come through Seoul to get to that North Korean army that's pushed Walton Walker's 8th Army down to that little cul-de-sac at the Pusan perimeter. So MacArthur believes you have to strike deep, you have to strike hard, you have to take that place that'll immediately take those supply lines. When he gives it to Struble, Struble's a little tentative, but then he's all for it. He's like, yep, this is the way it's going to go. I know the risks are there, but you know, I believe in this thing. Doyle is a little bit different. He's the guy who's got to pull it all off. He's very, and the main thing he'll say to MacArthur is it's not impossible. You know, everything is going against us going there, but it's not impossible.
Which to MacArthur means
really freaked out.
Which to MacArthur means it's totally doable. It'll work out great. Don't worry.
That's the thing. When the JCS wants to come out there and talk to MacArthur about it, they come out there expecting to, you know, talk him into going lower down at Kunsan, which is where Shepard and the Marines want to go. It's where, you know, Doyle wants to go. It's where Forrest Sherman wants to go. But Forrest Sherman, J. Lawton Collins, the chief of staff, they'll come out to MacArthur to talk about in August. Now, Opie Smith has already arrived out there, the 1st Marine Division commander. And he's gone in to see MacArthur and he was like, you know, we should go to Kunsan. And MacArthur, he says he's got this mystical belief. You know, it's not this, oh, this is going to work. It's, you know, no, I feel it. You know, this is going to happen. This is going to work. Nobody's going to talk him out of it. And the same thing when the JCS gets with him, you know, all the naval experts get up and talk about why they can't do this. And one of the guys gets up and says, you know, as a naval gunfire expert, you know, a commander, you know, I don't think we're going to need 12 days of bombardment. And Forrest Sherman is there. He's like, you know, I've forgotten more about naval gunfire than you're ever going to know. Would you sit down? It'll only take a day and a half to go and bomb that place. So this Sherman's already immediately on MacArthur's page, you know, and then they're all going through this thing and MacArthur will finally get up to speak and they're all like, great, he's going to talk about the op. And MacArthur gets up and starts talking about Wolfe and Montcalm, you know, at Quebec and the Plains of Abraham. And everybody's like, what are you talking about? But to MacArthur, it's all surprise. I mean, and he's set, you know, I'm going to land at Incheon and I'll crush him. The next day, the Navy guys and the Marine guys come back and say, hey, let's do this Kunsan thing. And he's like, nope, that's not going to happen that way. And so that's what does it, you know, and it's like only a week before the invasion that they give him the go ahead, you know, to go for this thing. You know, Doyle has planned it very well. They've got two typhoons that roll in right before they do this thing, which probably helps, you know, shield it a lot. They're going to have those horrible problems with the tide. They'll look in, they, you know, all of a sudden they've got a few mines there at Flying Fish Channel, and that's going to wake them up that the North Koreans have actually, you know, done a lot of mining. There's not too many at Incheon, but they'll get into it later. And so that's how it, you know, that's how it's brought together, you know, how they'll do this. MacArthur is a lot like the World War II. The Navy will control the whole operation until the Army Command is on shore until the Marine Corps Command is on shore, and then the Army will come in. Ned Ullman under 10th Corps will come in as commander of the 7th Division and the 1st Marine Division that will go in there. And then as well, MacArthur says Navy Air will run this. They're the experts. They know how to do this. They'll have the USS Sicily and the Bedong Strait with the Bedong Sea, aircraft carriers, when they'll be running interdiction raids against any kind of North Koreans coming into the rescue. And, MacArthur knows that these guys are the ones that'll do it. So he keeps the Air Force, pretty much out of the whole mission,
Let's talk about the Marines for a minute. Now, obviously, the Marine Corps is a major part of MacArthur's argument in favor of landing at Incheon. And this is, I think, both practical and calculated on MacArthur's part. After Iwo Jima, the Marines thought that they would exist forever, that there would always be a Marine Corps. But post-war budget cuts in that interwar year period between World War II and Korea has the Marine Corps kind of in a bit of a bind. You have other services trying to gobble up its mission to save money. And the Marines are in a pretty tough spot, I think, by 1950. So is it true that MacArthur saves the Marine Corps, keeps it relevant, or does the Marine Corps' willingness to participate in Incheon save MacArthur's vision for Incheon?
Yeah, I think it's a little bit of both. When MacArthur first tasked the 1st Cavalry Division to do that invasion, that was because they had one day of training. Doyle's first amphibious training in Japan was the day the war broke out, June 25th, and he was using the 1st Cavalry Division. So that's why MacArthur, goes then. But after about a month, he knows he's going to need Marines to do this. And so he goes to Lem Shepard and says, I really would love to have the 1st Marine Division, here. And Shepard was like, well, I run them, but you have to ask for them, from the JCS. And MacArthur has Shepard sit down in his office and type out the request for getting them. He knows that he's going to get a regimental combat team from the Marines. That's going to be Taplett's 5th Marines, which will go in there, Pusan, and be Walton Walker's fire brigade. But they're also going to put together the 1st Marine Regiment and the 7th Marines. And the thing is, these guys aren't a division. They're all over the world. And they start bringing them into Camp Pendleton and getting them ready. And so by the time of when the JCS agrees to it, MacArthur will have the 5th and the 1st Marines there, 1st Marines under Chesty Puller and Ray Murray, and Taplett got the 5th. But the 7th is not going to come till later. So when he goes into Incheon, he's going to just have those two Marine regiments that go in there. The thing is that these guys have no practice. They don't do any practice runs. They've never worked together as a division before. You've got all these World War II guys in there, and it just shows that it's the professionalism of the U.S. Marine Corps that makes this thing really work. They go into Womido Island, first that morning with the first invasion, and knock that out. And then in the afternoon, about 5 o'clock, there's very confused landings on the other blue and green beaches. But you've got it's so disorganized. But as soon as Chesty Puller's on the ground, it's totally organized. And so Truman had called the Marines the Navy's police force, that they were, the police force of the Navy. And so when they pull this off, it pretty much does ensure their continuance for the next, till today. And you can say that, that's the biggest favor MacArthur does, but it's, Incheon is a wild plan, it's a bold operation, but it's just that professionalism of the Navy and the Marine Corps that will make this work. And it's a tribute to the both of them. But is it MacArthur saving them or the Marines saving MacArthur's vision of Incheon? I'd say it's a lot of the both.
So sum up Incheon then, and how does it impact MacArthur's vision of the Navy and the Marine Corps, and then vice versa? Does this success there change the way all the different sides see each other?
Well, the success of Incheon is kind of soured Immediately, because the 10th Corps commander is Ned Alman, Major General, and he had been MacArthur's chief of staff. And that was the goofiest thing of the war, is MacArthur splitting 8th Army and 10th Corps, keeping them divided. But he'll put O.P. Smith's 1st Marine Division under Ned Alman. Then these two are not going to get along at all. Alman is very acerbic. He's a very aggressive commander, but he calls O.P. Smith son. You know, not general or anything, like, listen, son. And O.P. Smith is older than him, you know, and has had a lot more amphibious experience than Ned Alman's going to have. And plus, they immediately get into that fight for Seoul, which is a vicious, vicious fight. About 2 weeks, they'll have to do a cross river, run on it. And so, you know, at say, like, right after Incheon, MacArthur goes into Ascom City, and they're on that hill. Everybody knows MacArthur is the man, because he's the one who pulled this off, or went for it when everybody said it wouldn't work. Brigadier General Simmons, who ran Marine history for a long while, was a young lieutenant, was there and said there were so many stars on that field, but there was only one man you saw, and that was MacArthur. And he was taller than anybody. But when you get into that fight for Seoul, it starts to sour a bit. You know, and it's also because of that Ned Alman, O.P. Smith confrontation, which is just going to get worse as time goes on. MacArthur is going to think these guys can do anything. He's going to, as he said in that conference with the JCS, he said, I believe I have more confidence in the Navy than the Navy has in itself. And he'll also see the Marines as being able to take care of anything. And he said that in World War II, you know, I know what the Marines think of me, but I also know when you need a job done, they're the ones you've got to turn to. So Incheon goes off. They all think it's great. It's getting a little rough there at Seoul, but once they move into North Korea and the North Koreans are evaporating, you know, they all think this thing's gonna, you know, end until the, you know, they have to go up on that next amphibious run. Yeah.
So after Incheon, MacArthur is eventually given the go-ahead to cross the 38th parallel and to take the war into North Korea. What role does the Navy and the Marine Corps play at that point?
Well, like we just said, MacArthur, when they push forward, he immediately starts thinking another amphibious move. Put the 10th Corps back on the ships, take them around to the east coast of North Korea and land at the biggest harbor in North Korea, which is Wonsan. Doyle's not really for this. You know, the amphibious commander, the Marines think as well, they'd be much better off just moving on foot into North Korea. Because when they get over to Wonsan, the South Koreans are already there. And Wonsan is completely and totally mined. And that's where they find out that control of the waters doesn't work when you can't get anybody in anywhere because of these mines. And you don't have the minesweepers to be able to run this. And so now they're invested in moving into Wonsan, clearing the things. And they waste, you know, a few weeks before they can even get in there. And by that time, they've already, you know, the army's moved up towards Pyongyang, and the South Koreans have moved up towards the coast, the capital division up there around Wonsan. And so you're not moving into North Korea until about early November. Meanwhile, all those Marine troops are on the ships for 2 weeks, going back and forth, atrophy, you know, setting in, because they're all just, you know, sitting on the bunks in there. And so then you're going to drop the Marines into Wonsan and start making that drive up north. And by this time, MacArthur thinks it's over. You know, he's going to lose sight of the battlefield until late October. And that's when the Chinese 13th Army Group comes in there on the Chongchon River. The Marines, as they start moving up that road to go to the Chosin Reservoir, they'll start hitting Chinese. And so the Navy will be doing, you know, conducting close air support, you know, interdiction missions, things like that. And they'll be looking at that home by Christmas, you know, fervor as well. But the Marines know different because they're encountering Chinese. And Ned Almond is just like, just drive to the Yalu. And O.P. Smith is like, nope, I'm going to leave group here at Kota Ri. I'm going to leave a group here at Agaru. As they move up to Udomni, they're going to leave a, you know, a group of Fox Company at Tok Tong Pass to be able to protect all those routes coming back in case they, you know, find themselves bad. Because after Chong Chon, when the 8th Army really gets smacked really bad, MacArthur's going to try and bomb out the entire area of North Korea and hold off any forces coming in. But now Song Shilun's moved in those 180,000 troops right up above the Chosin Reservoir with about 12 divisions of 9th Army Group. And so that's going to set the stage for what happens with the Marines. And when they go for that home for Christmas drive, where MacArthur's going to try the double envelopment with 10 Corps and 8th Army, just destroyed that first day as the Chinese spring their trap. It was the greatest cover and deception plan that the United States has ever seen. We need to remember that today. But the Chinese spring that trap, and all of a sudden you've got the Marines surrounded. And that again shows to the testament, because they will destroy all those 10, 12 Chinese divisions as they fight their way out of Udomni, Agaru. You know, we could do a whole 2 hours on just that. Because that's just the story of the thing. But the Marines will fight their way all the way back to Hung Nam, you know, and that's where the Navy will be waiting.
All right, so tell us then about how the Navy evacuates some of these forces in North Korea. And it really seems like they were preparing for the possibility of this, even as MacArthur remains very optimistic about what's happening there. But the Navy seems to be very ready to start these evacuations.
Well, once the word comes of what happens in Chosin, the 27th, when those, you know, three divisions go against the 7th up there at Udomni, Doyle knows what's up immediately, and so does Struble, and they start getting ready for an evac. The thing is that even as O.P. Smith was pulling back to Hung Nam to be pulled out, he's thinking they're going to establish a redoubt there. And that's what Doyle thinks as well. And they'll use naval bombardment to hold the Chinese off, you know, 20 miles, 30 miles inland with, you know, Missouri's big guns. And they're thinking this on the West Coast as well, at Chenam Po, that they'll recall the 8th Army there, 10th Corps here, and they'll hold these two positions, resupply, and then go back in at it. And as in 2020 hindsight, that's what a lot of them believe they should have done. MacArthur, however, is staring into the blackness. Is this World War III? You know, this is a surprise attack by the Chinese. All of a sudden, you've got MiGs all over the place around the Yalu River and MiG Alley. And he's going to start thinking, bomb Manchuria, blockade China, use Chang's troops. And basically thinking to broaden the war, you know, not invade China or anything like that. He never had that in his mind, but he believes that he needs to bring all forces to bear because he thinks this is going to go to World War III. And so the Navy, even though, like I said, they'll differ on the opinion, Doyle thinking that redoubt, but as soon as he gets those orders for the evacuation, that's the rule of the day. They'll bring the 1st Marine Division out, they'll get the 3rd Division out, they'll get the 7th Division out, they'll get 100,000 Korean civilians out, and they won't really lose anybody in this evacuation. And MacArthur wants them all back south of the 38th parallel to hold off the Chinese onslaught, you know, which is now coming and retaking Seoul. So a lot of consternation and confusion, and but the Navy again, once again, and the Marines pull it off, and the professionalism is just once again on full display, and it's America's Thermopylae, you know, or Thermopylae. It's one of the greatest stories in American history, that 1st Marine Division getting out of the Chosin.
For sure. So at this point, in terms of policy, this is to be a limited war, right? But MacArthur is not trying to win a limited war. He is trying to win the war. So does he lose in these later days, does he begin to lose the support of the Navy, the Marine Corps, perhaps even the Army, you know, back in DC? Are they starting to feel that the official policy and what he's trying to do are not clicking? Is that happening?
Yes, there's a, it's more with the JCS though, you know, the Joint Chiefs of Staff, of what they are considering now and what MacArthur is considering, because they don't, you know, it's like Bradley says, wrong war, wrong place, wrong time. Whereas MacArthur sees it in the sense of, well, if we don't deal with this now, we'll be dealing with it 80 years from now, you know, today. And so it's more in that, sense, because, you know, the people on the ground, they're wondering the same thing as MacArthur. Is this World War III? Are the Soviets coming into this thing? You've still got the problem with Ned Almond and the Marine Corps as they get down south. But in late December, Walton Walker, the 8th Army commander, gets killed in that Jeep accident. And that's where they bring in Matthew Ridgway. And whereas MacArthur felt like he always had to watch Almond and Walker closely, except for in those last days of the war, of the drive north, he's going to have utmost confidence in Ridgway. And Ridgway goes in and immediately gets those Marines out of Almond's control and clamps down, unites the whole force, gets it all together, and starts reinstilling confidence in everybody. And they'll put together those drives that will eventually, you know, reach back to the 38th parallel. So even though you know, the Chinese have come in and there's a little shaken, I think Ridgway restores that confidence, like, no problem, we're going to handle this. You know, but the thing is even Ridgway in early January is asking for chemical weapons, you know, in case they get drawn down to another Dunkirk. So all of them are kind of on that same page of not really seeing where they are. I mean, Ridgway has no idea or no doubt that he can hold off the Chinese, but he just wants to have all weapons at his disposal, you know, to be able to do this. And MacArthur, of course, tells him, no, we can't do that. You're getting into a realm that, you know, is way beyond us, which shows that MacArthur isn't willing to just use everything to destroy everybody. But does it come to the point where they start doubting in him? I think maybe that'll come later. You know, is after everybody's home, had about five years to think about it. But, you know, people on the field haven't really lost any. And as, when MacArthur gets relieved, a lot of them will just be like, I can't believe it. You know, he was the guy who had the only vision on winning this thing. But then a lot of them as well are just like, well, he's gone. This is my job. It doesn't matter that he's gone. You know, Ridgway's in control now. Van Fleet's here. And so I think it's more in that sense. You know, these guys are men. They've made the decision to be where they're going to be, and they're going to, you know, do the best they can to make things work no matter who's in charge.
Okay. Well then, after MacArthur's fired in April 1951, does the role of the Navy or Marine Corps change under Ridgway or later under Clark?
Well, once they get that 38th parallel established, then it just becomes that stalemate. You know, our time kind of ends in Korea in April of 1951. And we've done, you know, a lot of things about the entire course of the war, but it seems like it gets into that stalemate position, and it's going to be pretty much like World War One, you know, and the Marines are now thrown into this World War One situation again, where you're fighting for yards. It's going to be a lot of close air support. When Van Fleet comes in, he wants to do another amphibious end run around the North Koreans, but the JCS isn't going to let that happen because they don't want to invest any more in the war. They just want to get an end to it. And so they'll sit there for 2 years. You know, on that line. And that's where MacArthur calls it murder. You know, if you have no intention of trying to win it, then all you're doing is just murdering these people. And you'll have 2-3 times the casualties in those last days of stalemate, you know, last years of stalemate than you did during MacArthur's war or of maneuver. So, yeah.
Right, but then to finish up, how do you think the Korean War shapes Marine Corps and Navy perspectives of MacArthur today? Because we talked to a lot of people in the service and they have a lot of interesting opinions and feelings about MacArthur across the board. But what do you think about that?
Well, you know, we just had somebody recently who's currently serving, you know, who said that he believed that MacArthur just rolled the dice with the troops and took a lot of risks that weren't necessary. You can see that somewhat here in Korea. I think the Navy is a lot more about World War II than Korea, you know, as far as having that criticism of them. But I think it's like with everybody, and we've seen this with people that do a lot of research. They'll come in not thinking much of him at all, hating him. But after they do a great deal of research, they see there's a lot more to the story than just, you know, it's all his fault. You know, there's a lot of intricacies and a lot of, the personalities, especially, you know, they'll be critical of MacArthur, but, you know, they, after, you know, it got to the end where they see where China's become now, they look at it in the sense of, well, maybe he did know, you know, what was up, you know, so. It's, we see it every day, but you know, the people are, that's the way it is. MacArthur's got a 52-year career and there's a lot to criticize and a lot to, you know, admire about it. And here we are.